Do you struggle with poor sleep? Did you know that bad sleep can actually ruin your life? Want to know how to get the best sleep you've ever gotten? Well, you picked the right video because I happen to be a sleep expert. Okay, I'm not actually a sleep expert, but I am an expert on a book by a sleep expert. In Why We Sleep, celebrated author and neuroscientist Matthew Walker demystifies the sleep process and urges us to take a closer look at our sleeping habits. According to Walker, who is both a sleep researcher and a well-respected professor of psychology, good sleep is vital to our ability to survive and thrive. In this video, we'll explore how sleep actually works, why it matters, what gets in the way of good sleep, and how to get the best sleep of your life. Let's jump right in. Sleep is one of those things we're so used to that we don't really think much about it. But what's happening behind the scenes when we drift off to dreamland? How does sleep actually work? Well, for starters, Walker says there are two mechanisms that regulate your sleep: your circadian rhythm and a chemical called adenosine. Your circadian rhythm is basically like your body's internal clock. It regulates when you're awake and when you go to sleep. And that cycle is entirely controlled by something called melatonin. Melatonin is a hormone produced in the body that makes you sleepy. It responds to light and darkness. The darker it is, the more melatonin released, the sleepier you get. Adenosine is a chemical produced in the body that makes you feel more and more pressure to sleep. The longer you're awake, the more the body produces it, and the more urgent your need to sleep gets. Then, sleeping brings your adenosine levels back down. So in the morning, when you wake up, you no longer feel a desire to sleep, which makes me wonder if we're all broken. Because seriously, show me an adult who wakes up in the morning willingly. Once you're finally asleep, your brain spends the night switching back and forth between two types of sleep: rapid eye movement and non-rapid eye movement. During non-REM sleep, the activity in your brain is very slow. You dream very little, if at all. The point of this type of sleep is to help your brain clear out mental trash and store important information in your long-term memory. When you're in REM sleep, brain activity is much faster and dreams are very common. Time is suspended and your body is basically in a temporary paralysis mode. It locks up so you don't act out your dreams in real life. This is where you make sense of your day or work through issues stuck in your subconscious mind. Dreaming is valuable for this because it helps you process information in a less rational, more creative way. As you can see, some pretty important stuff happens during REM and non-REM sleep. If you truly want to cash in on your sleep benefits, you'll need to make friends with both. So now that you have some basics on the what and the how of sleep, let's talk about the why. For better or for worse, the quality of your sleep affects the way your body, mind, and emotions function. One benefit is that high-quality sleep supports brain function. It does this in three ways. 1. Boosting long-term memory. The sleep process helps you separate important information from unimportant information, so you can securely store the stuff you need in your long-term memory. Deciding what info matters most leads us to the second benefit of good sleep, which is clearing old memories no longer needed. Think of your brain like the home screen on your computer. Sleep helps the brain get rid of unnecessary junk, so you have more storage space for brand new information, like clearing out old files you don't need off your desktop. 3. Increasing muscle memory. Good sleep makes you better at any tasks that require motor skills, like tying knots, brushing your teeth, or putting on clothes. It helps your brain turn a conscious task into a muscle memory task. For example, this is the process at play when you first learn to drive. At first, it's overwhelming and feels like too much to focus on at once. But eventually, you might do an entire drive and realize you weren't thinking about driving at all. Another benefit is that sleep helps you process painful memories and experiences. During REM sleep, you tend to dream. Dreams allow your brain to creatively integrate difficult experiences you've had by releasing the emotional pain and holding on to important insights learned. When you get good sleep, you understand your emotions and the emotions of others better. For example, sleep-deprived people are seen as more hostile and see others as more hostile. When you get good sleep, you are more likely to have a deeper empathy for yourself and for others. Another benefit of REM sleep is the way it boosts creative thinking and problem solving. You're able to absorb complicated ideas more deeply and easily during REM sleep. You're also able to make new connections in the brain that you wouldn't normally make while awake. On the flip side, when you get bad sleep, there are many short-term and long-term consequences. The first consequence is loss of concentration. It's not entirely clear what mechanisms are at play here, but when you lose sleep, you have a worse attention span and a harder time concentrating on things. For example, remember the last time you were super tired and needed to drive somewhere? It probably took some extra effort to stay alert and focused on the road, right? Your brain simply can't muster up the energy as easily as when you're well rested. Another consequence of lost sleep is loss of emotional control. Bad sleep messes with your amygdala. This is a problem because the amygdala is the part of your brain that regulates emotion. According to Walker, when you're sleep deprived, your amygdala can't help you control your feelings. You become a whopping 60% more reactive. The third and scariest consequence is a higher risk for disease. Because we need our brains so much to function well, poor sleep actually interrupts many of our body's processes, leading to diseases like heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and Alzheimer's. Research shows sleep loss has a clear effect on the risk of Alzheimer's in particular. It makes the disease progress faster because it keeps your brain from cleaning out bad plaque. The bad news is most of us are probably not getting the kind of sleep we need. But the good news is we have some ideas about what gets in the way of it. And once you know what your obstacles are, it's easier to find solutions to them. There are 6 common obstacles to good sleep habits. Number 1 is caffeine. I know, this is devastating news for coffee lovers. But remember adenosine, the chemical that makes you want to sleep? Well, caffeine blocks the receptors for it. So every time adenosine tries to communicate with your brain, it hits a brick wall. It can scream, "You need sleep, you dummy!" But the brain won't get the message and you won't feel like sleeping, which kind of makes it hard to get good sleep, right? Obstacle number 2 is artificial light. Our bodies are designed to wake up and go to sleep with the cycles of day and night. Light signals the daytime and makes you alert. Dark signals the nighttime and makes you sleepy. But in this wacky modern world, we can have artificial light at any time. This keeps us from producing melatonin and throws our circadian rhythm off, leaving us with worse sleep. Another obstacle is artificial temperature. Just like with light, our bodies also get cues to sleep from the temperature. Cold makes you sleepy, heat makes you alert. But again, in the modern world, we can control the temperature. So our brains and bodies get confused, making it hard to get into good sleep habits and experience high quality sleep. Brace yourself, this might be another hard one to swallow. Obstacle number 4 is alcohol, and I know what you're thinking. You're thinking about the times you had a few too many and easily passed out in some less than ideal places. Unfortunately, even though alcohol can certainly knock you out, you're not really asleep. It's more like you're under anesthesia, like during a surgery. It's a very light sleep, so you don't drop into REM, and usually you wake up throughout the night. Another big obstacle is sleeping pills. When it comes to sleeping pills, just say no. According to research, sleeping pills aren't much better than placebo at helping you fall asleep. Plus, they cause next day drowsiness. And you could also get addicted to them, worsening your sleep cycle in the long run. And last but not least, obstacle number 6 is your friendly neighborhood alarm clock. Most standard alarms are super jarring. So when you wake up from an alarm, your body goes into distress mode. Your cortisol levels, heart rate, and blood pressure all spike. And you're going to hear that alarm every single day. Yikes. Not exactly a good way to set yourself up for peaceful sleep in the long term. I think the obstacle I struggle the most with is artificial light. Often I stay up later than I should to get work done on my phone or computer. This delays the production of melatonin, and I can definitely feel it. Lately, I've been trying to keep on as little light as possible in my room to help prepare my body for sleep, but I need to work harder at putting my electronics away earlier. Luckily, Walker has plenty of suggestions for improving sleep. And get your notepad ready because I'm about to give you 4 of them. First, keep a consistent sleep schedule. When you sleep at the same time for the same amount of time each night, it's easier to set yourself up for high quality sleep in the long term. And of course, it's equally important to get the correct amount of sleep. For example, sleeping from 1 a.m. to 6 a.m. each night won't do you much good if you need 8 hours of sleep to function at your best. If you don't do this, you're putting yourself at risk for something called a sleep deficit. This means that there's a gap between how much sleep you need and how much you actually get. The more complete and consistent your sleep schedule, the less risk there will be a gap, and the better the quality of your sleep will be over time. Number 2, practice good sleep hygiene. Remember all those obstacles we just discussed? Having good sleep hygiene means addressing all of them. Dim your lights early, create a quiet environment, lower the temperature. Avoid alcohol, caffeine, exercise, or naps before bedtime. Avoid sleeping pills. Try less jarring alarm clock alternatives. The more you can do to make sleep easier to drop into, the better. 3. Get regular exercise. While it's not great to exercise before bed, studies show that regular daytime exercise will help you sleep longer and sleep better. Tip number 4 is to stick to a simple, healthy diet. Poor or overly complex diets with high carb counts lead to restless sleep. A healthy diet with an average calorie count and a low carb count promotes better non-REM sleep throughout the night. These tips will work for most people, as many of us tend to struggle with sleep in similar ways. That being said, our society doesn't exactly have the kind of culture that supports healthy sleep. Sometimes poor sleep turns into a habit and becomes chronic. If you find yourself really struggling and these tips don't hit the spot, consider exploring an alternative approach like sleep therapy. Research shows that cognitive behavioral therapy can also be an effective way to treat insomnia if it develops. Well, there you have it, folks. The mystery of sleep demystified. Now you know how sleep works, why it's a big deal, why we struggle with it, and how to sleep like a rock star. The full book has lots of great insights into sleep that we didn't have time to cover in this video. If you're interested in going deeper, check out the Shortform Guide to Why We Sleep. Shortform makes the world's best guides to nonfiction books. They're like book summaries on steroids. You can get a 5-day free trial and a discounted annual subscription if you go to shortform.com/YouTube. Click the link in the description below and support the author and publisher by buying Why We Sleep. A link to buy the book is below as well. And finally, hit the subscribe button so that you don't miss the next Shortform video. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time.